the infamous tongue and groove notch method of felling a tree. I made an Instagram reel a few months back where I was taking down a little maple tree that was close to my shop. And it was a little tree, it was maybe, what, 8 or 10 inches, and I'd already topped it. There wasn't a lot there. And so I thought, hey, this is a great place to try out the tongue and groove notch. Made a quick video about it, and you know, one of the great things about the internet is when you do something incorrectly, there's a few people that are kind enough to help you out with that. And so I thought, all right, I'm gonna set the record straight on how to do a tongue and groove notch correctly. And if you've watched this video all the way to the end, I am going to give one tip that I am surprised a lot of people don't know when they're using trees that they've cut down for firewood. So stay tuned for that. But let's get started on this tree. Now the problem with this tree is it is just an ugly red oak. It's been kind of struggling for a while. It's hanging off the side of this steep bank on my property. And I wanted to take it down because, well, it's ugly and it's maybe blocking a little bit of the light that could be getting to my greenhouse. And so the one thing that I wanted to avoid was it hitting this little cherry tree that we've lovingly named Elswith here on our property. And I didn't want to hit Elswith with this oak tree. And so what I did was first I tied it back as far as I could without stressing the tree out. And then I spec'd out the tree for the tongue and groove notch. Now, the trick with the tongue and groove notch is you first cut your traditional directional notch, just like you would be cutting the tree down normally. But then, off of the bottom plane of that notch, you cut two slashes, plunge cut, all the way through the tree. And those make up the tongue. Next, what you do is you cut the bottom of the tongue free and you make sure to give it some space. And so you cut a little bit of extra off of that because the tree is eventually gonna plunk down on that spot. Fortunately for me, this tree has already got a heavy lean bias out over the driveway. And so I don't need to use a wedge or anything to give this tree any help in the direction that it's gonna go because it's gonna go this way. The next thing is two little nicks on the top of either side of the tongue on the back side of the tree. And it doesn't take much. A couple inches on either side and you'll set it free. So there you have it, the tongue and groove notch method of felling a tree. Now, obviously this isn't something you're going to use on every tree. It has its application, but in this instance, I'm happy. It fell straight, it didn't hit the cherry tree, and so win-win, everything's good. This tree is an unusual tree because it was, you know, top heavy, it was leaning towards the driveway, so it was gonna go this way. And so it was a pretty good candidate, in my opinion, for a tongue and groove notch cut. But since I'm not a commercial arborist, I'm curious to hear from any of you out there that are professional tree cutters and arborists, what is the application of that method of cutting? I really do want to know the answer to that question. And if you could, let me know in the comments below. And if you're a homeowner or a homesteader of that type, have you ever done it? Have you had success? I would also like to know that. Now, I mentioned that there was a tip that I wanted to give you. And that's something that I'm surprised a lot of people don't know that use these types of trees for firewood. And that is actually something that's kind of happening behind me. I had to cut up and remove the portion of the tree that was laying in the driveway. But the portion that's laying down the hillside, I left all the limbs and the leaves on it. And the reason is the capillary action of the leaves is going to continue to draw moisture out of that tree for a while. And so it's kind of a cool way of getting a head start on the seasoning of the firewood. It might make a little bit of a difference on how long it takes. So there you go, kind of a useful tip. Now, You know how YouTube works, so if you like this video, if it was useful to you, like and subscribe, all that stuff. And if you liked this video, it's possible that you might like these.